Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I have done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Well might the sun in darkness hide and shut his glories in, when Christ the mighty Maker died for man the creature's sin. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away, 'tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Amen, God. I thank you for this day. I thank you for your goodness, Lord. I pray, God, you'd be with us in this service this morning. Help us, Lord, to stay focused and distraction-free, to hear your word loud and clear, and exactly what you would like us to hear today. Well, thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 All right, you can be seated. Luke 24 is where we'll be. Luke 24. I'm going to read up to verse 12. Luke 24. If you know this passage, it's a post-resurrection passage. And Christ has arose, amen, and now he is starting to reveal himself unto his own people. And so in Luke 24, the first part that we're going to look at is verses 1 through 12. Let me read it. Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre, and they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words, and returned from the sepulchre, and told all these things unto the 11, and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, and Joanna, and Mary the mother of James, and other women that were with them, which told these things unto the apostles. And their words seemed to be, or those, their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed them not. Then arose Peter and ran unto the sepulchre, and stooping down, he beheld the linen clothes laid by themselves, and departed, wondering in himself at that which was come to pass. What I'm talking about this morning is women that were with them. Women that were with them. That's taken from verse 10 there. And it takes you a while in the context of chapter 24 to grab that it's actually the women that are being discussed here. But if you look right in the chapter previous, it says in verse 55, and the women also which came with him from Galilee followed after. So the context, again, in the scriptures rolls right on over. It's one thing we need to remember when we're reading our scriptures is there's always just this hard line division where the context leaves one and goes to another every time a chapter break happens. But that's just an aside. What I want to focus on is the women that were with them. The women and how they played a role in this early passage about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In the first verse there, now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre bringing spices which they had prepared and certain others with them. And the thing I want to draw our attention to right there is two things, early in the morning and prepared. These women went out and I believe showed great virtue and great righteousness in that they went early in the morning and they were prepared for the work which they had yet to do. Keep your finger there in Luke chapter 24 and go with me to Psalm chapter 5. Psalm chapter 5, right there in the middle of your Bible. The idea of being very early in the morning, ready unto receive something from God, ready unto prayer, ready unto whatsoever your day brings forth. Being ready early in the morning is a great virtue, and it's a great thing that many righteous people did within the scriptures. And if you look there in Psalm chapter 5, and in verse 3, we find this: my voice shalt thou hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee, and will look up. And I think every time I get a fresh Bible, that's almost one of the first verses I end up circling in my scriptures. My voice shalt thou hear in the morning. David promising, affirming to God that you'll hear me in the morning, O Lord. In the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee and will look up. He's setting himself forward for that purpose. First thing in the morning, prayers up unto God, and with purpose and with passion, even stating it in one of his psalms that he desires and declares that he will be there, Lord, in the morning. I will be there directing my prayer unto thee. Psalm chapter 57, if you would. Psalm chapter 57 has a similar aspect. Psalm 57, the psalmist says this, and in verse 7, Psalm 57, verse 7. My heart is fixed, O God. My heart is fixed. I will sing and give praise. Awake up, my glory. Awake, psaltery and harp. I myself will awake early. I will praise thee, O Lord, among the people. I will sing unto thee among the nations. For thy mercy is great unto the heavens, and thy truth unto the clouds. Be thou exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let thy glory be above all the earth. Again, David just affirming in his heart that he wants his song, he wants his praise to be something that is first and foremost in his life. He is going to arise early in the morning along with his psaltery and along with his harp. Awake, awake, my glory. I will praise thee, O Lord, he says. And he says, I myself will do that, will awake early and direct my steps unto thee in that fashion. Just over the page in Psalm chapter 63, we have this. O God, thou art my God, early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. To see thy power and thy glory, so as I have seen thee in the sanctuary, because thy loving kindness is better than life. My lips shall praise thee. Again, prayer up to God, and that early, that first thing, that first mindfulness that comes upon the psalmist, he says, early will I seek thee. Early will I seek thee. Just as the women did within the context of Luke chapter 4. Early in the morning, very early in the morning even, they were there at the sepulcher. They were ready. And now, just in case I want to go and take these scriptures and not apply them to myself, we have Joshua chapter 3. We have Joshua chapter 6 and verse 12, Joshua 7 and verse 16, and Joshua 8 and verse 10 that says this exact statement. Joshua rose up early in the morning. And that burns my flesh because I really love sleeping in. I really love to just roll over and grab those few extra Z's and curl myself up in that blanket and just embrace those last few minutes of sleep, letting the alarm go to the very last minute when I know that I absolutely have to get up and get ready for work. But as the psalmist did, he said, as a thirsty and dry land, he was going to seek after God. As something that was so needful as water is to the flesh, He desired to seek God early in the Spirit, directing his prayers unto him and look up. And we need to get that same thing in our mentality and into our minds and into our lives. Joshua rose up early in the morning. I mean, I can't do anything to make that not personal. I can't do anything to get that verse away from me because it's even using my namesake very clearly. Joshua rose up early in the morning. And honestly, I have found in my life and in my experience when I do so, when I am up and when I am prepared, not just out of bed and off to work, not just out of bed and maybe brush my teeth and comb my hair and do whatever I have to go and just get right into the day. But when I give myself some time in that morning, just a little window of time where I can seek the Lord, where I can pray unto God, where I can just be quiet and in a routine that sets itself first unto God, I find my day goes a lot smoother. I find I have a bounce in my step, a joy in my heart that I don't get when I'm just up and out, up and out, and in that rigmarole. That's so needful to Christians. And the ladies within the context of this scripture, the women that were with them in this group as they went unto the sepulcher, prepared to give the Lord of that offering that they had, they knew and they demonstrated what it means to go very early in the morning. And that's a great principle we can all grab after. Again, you can go with me to 2 Chronicles 19. I'm going to read again the context we're looking at. Now, upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulcher, bringing spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. Preparation, being prepared unto what the day has ahead of you, what the day has in store, is so needful. And 2 Chronicles describes this idea of preparation and being prepared. 2 Chronicles 9. In 2 Chronicles chapter 19, 2 Chronicles 19, we have that story of Jehoshaphat and the offense that he made, and we'll read that here, 2 Chronicles 19 and verse 1. And Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, returned to his house in peace to Jerusalem. And Jehu, the son of Hanani, the seer, went out to meet him and said to King Jehoshaphat, "Shouldest thou help the ungodly and love them that hate the Lord? Therefore is wrath upon thee from before the Lord. Nevertheless, there are good things found in thee, in that thou hast taken away the groves out of the land and hast prepared thine heart to seek God." So even though he was yoked up with the world, even though he was helping the ungodly and encouraging those that hated God, essentially lifting up and working with and yoking with the reprobate, even though he was doing that wicked thing in his life and the wrath of God was upon him, the judgment of God was upon him in this world, the Bible records the voice of the prophet speaking, "Nevertheless, there are good things found in thee, because you've removed the idols from the land," though you're yoking up with the idol worshippers, "and also you have prepared thine heart to seek the Lord." And we need to do that as well. Be ready early in the morning. Prepare your heart to seek after the Lord. And that's something that we learn even here from the scriptures in the context of Luke chapter 24. There's a prepared place for a prepared person. I think we've all heard that. There's always an opportunity that God has ready and available for the person that is prepared unto the thing. There's nothing worse than having that God-ordained appointment with a lost soul and not being prepared to give the gospel. There's nothing worse than that. There's nothing worse than having a perfect situation in front of you and you're just simply not prepared unto the thing. The Bible records of Ezra the scribe. It says, Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord and to do it, and to teach in Israel statutes and judgments. And as a scribe, he had prepared his heart for that, and he was used greatly in doing exactly that. He was able to take of the law of the Lord, do the law of the Lord, and teach others to abide in that same judgment, to abide in that same righteousness, because he was a prepared, or the Bible calls it a ready scribe unto the Lord. He was ready. He was prepared for the work that would one day set before him. And each of us need to prepare our hearts in that same way. Get up early, get prepared for your day. But get up early in the realm of your whole life and early seek after God. Be prepared for the things of God, because you don't know what God has planned for you next year, or God has planned for you 3 years from now. We need to always be in the mindset and in the heart that has to seek after God, to get close to God, to learn of God, and be prepared unto the things of God. John chapter 1 describes the preaching that prepares a man. You see in John chapter 1 and verse 17, for the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. You'll also see in John chapter 4 and verse 6, now Jacob's well was there. I don't even know if I'm in the right passage here. God often, wait a minute. God often has, and I think what I'm looking for is actually John the Baptist when he came out. He was setting forth preaching that would prepare a man to receive the Lord. That was the whole ministry that he had. He went before the people and presented the Savior. He prepared their heart. He set forth an entire nation with that same preparation of the heart, a man, a person, a people ready to meet their Maker. And that was his whole ministry. So you better believe a man like John the Baptist would have a great earnest desire to get up early in the morning and to prepare his heart in order that he could be in the ministry whereby he would prepare others for that same work, for that same mentality. In Luke chapter 24, we'll go back there. Luke chapter 24, in verse 2, it says, and they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. So the women arrive and they find this stone already rolled away. They expected to find the tomb closed. They expected to find one thing. And yet they weren't shaken when they found that. They did not fear, and rather they did not let their fear control them. They continued to move forward. 2 Timothy in chapter 1 and verse 7 says, God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of peace and of love and of a sound mind. And I used this verse even this week on Friday to give a woman who was so fearful of everything that was going on, that Armageddon was upon her, that her sins were going to take her to hell. She was afraid of getting sick. She was afraid of getting dying. She had so many fears, and I used this verse, even as it did to my wife so many years ago, to convince her that you must not have the Spirit of God, because that Spirit of God will not allow you to be in a fear of things like death, in a fear of things like the world coming down upon you, in the fear of things like facing the wrath of God in Armageddon. God has not given you that spirit. In the same way these women exhibited as they moved forward, though they found the stone removed, they did not let fear grab a hold of them. But rather, verse 3 says, and they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And even though they pressed, they received something, they saw something that they did not expect, they pressed on. And you read in verse 4, it says, and it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said unto him. So here you start to see some perplexion. You see some fear come upon them. But they did not use this fear to control them in any way, but to bow down here and in humility hear what's going to be preached of them from the angel of the Lord. And the angel of the Lord says this, why seek ye the living among the dead? Right? The truth is that, and they should have known this, was that when they came to the sepulcher on the third day, they should have expected that Jesus wouldn't be there. They should have expected that everything that he had said had come to pass. They should have expected to walk into an empty tomb, though they're perplexed when they actually find it. They're confused. They're worried. Much fear comes upon them in this moment, but they don't let the fear control them to where they can't hear the rebuke of the Lord come through that fear as he corrects them and as he ministers unto them in the second part of that verse when he says, why seek ye the living among the dead? And because they didn't use that time to just scatter and to run away as they're faced with the angel of the Lord, the messenger of the Lord here, they were able to hear the great news. He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again? And they hear this great news, and it must have been such a shock to them to hear it from the messenger that they did not expect. Though what was coming through the messenger of God was the exact same lessons that Christ had taught them. Do you not remember? Do you not remember what he told you when he said that he would be delivered? When he said he would be given unto sinful men, crucified? And here we are on the third day. Do you not remember that you should be finding an empty tomb? Glory to God, it's exactly what he told you and it's exactly what you ought to be expecting. And they heard that message because they weren't paralyzed by their fear. They didn't run away in fear. Rather, the women stayed put to hear what God had to say to them. And they remembered, verse 8, his words. They remembered the words of Jesus, though at this time they came from a different messenger, though at this time they came from a different voice. They remembered because they had heard it before. We can't remember something that we have never heard before. Too often, we consider some things that may have come out of our hearts, but in reality, they're not something in the scriptures, though we'll attribute it to that. We'll say things like, just those slogan-based Christianity things where we think it came from the Bible, but we never actually read it in the Bible. The reason why things come to our remembrance from the scriptures is because we have heard it before. And what was the reasoning? What was the way that these ladies had heard this thing before? Well, they remembered it because Christ had taught it. They remembered what they had heard because they were in church. They remembered what was heard because they had spent time with the Lord, personal time. And because these women, as they had often done before, were prepared. They were up early. They didn't fear, but pressed on humbly and received the word of God to remember what was taught. Because they did that, because they had the prepared heart, because they had already been in service with Christ month after month, week after week, year after year, as his ministry was in Galilee and in that time. Because they were already prepared and brought up and nourished in that position, there was that prepared place for a prepared people. Because the women were prepared unto that work, because they were up and ready to hear what God had for them that day, and they were ready to present unto him what they had to offer, they became the first to hear the good news, and they became the first to bring the good news. As it's recorded in verse 9, it says, and returned from the sepulcher. And that's all one thought. It says, and they remembered his words. And what did they do? As soon as they remembered the word of God, as soon as they had recollection of the word of God, it all came together. Of course, he said he would rise. Of course, there's an empty tomb. Immediately, the women returned from the sepulcher and told all these things unto 11 and to all the rest. It seems like they didn't leave any stone unturned. They charged right into the city, right into the place where they were gathered, and told the 11 and all the rest the great news that Christ is risen. And you'd expect these men to have the mentality that, of course he is. Of course, we were expecting the risen Savior. We were expecting an empty grave. But no, they had the exact opposite effect. They had the same effect that the women did in the beginning. The Bible records here, it said it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and other women that were with them, which told these things unto the apostles. And they came charging into the city, rejoicing. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. And they're the first to bring that great, great story of Christ and his salvation, and Christ and his promises coming true, and Christ risen to sit at the right hand of the Father. And they charge into the city, and they're expecting a great reception of the men rejoicing. But verse 11 records that their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed them not. Then arose Peter, and he has to go and do what Peter does. They did not expect, I believe, that same type of reception. In their minds, they must have been like, the disciples, or they're just going to get it. They're just going to know. They're just going to connect the dots. Maybe they already know because they believe the scriptures. But they needed to have the same rebuke that Christ had given to them. They needed to receive the same thing, because men are so, and especially in times of turmoil and suffering, they just saw their Savior go through the beatings and the whipping and the scourging, nailed on a cross and died. They were hopeless. They were without a hope. They were just crushed beneath the rapture of the situation, swept away in the emotional side of it all. And they just didn't know how to connect the dots within their mind, because their emotions have driven them in such turmoil. Though when it connected to the women and they charged into the city and told them and all the women, they were received as if it was just but idle tales. But even still, we have to commend the women for being the first in that long line of soul winners, the first to connect the dots about what it means to be saved, the finished work of Christ upon the cross, and to know that, and to immediately, when it all comes to fruition, and now you're saved, their first desire was to go and to tell others. And that's the same kind of mentality that I love seeing within this group here. We love to tell that great story. But it's not something that we're just going to do on a Saturday, that it's a great big soul winning marathon, a great big event that's worldwide, so that we can have our names numbered with that. I was telling Brother Yuri the same thing. I love the fact that it just looked to me yesterday like a great Saturday. Just the same old people that are week in, week out soul winners. Yes, we had some guests, and that's great to have. But week in, week out soul winners. They're the same whether there's a great big event or whether they're caught up at work late and just have to go out on their own. They're going to week after week. And I love seeing that in the people of this church as a whole. I love it especially even to see it within the ladies. And the ladies exhibit this so much, and I really enjoyed that. Seeing that the other day, I love that our church as a whole shows forth our willingness to serve the Lord, not just on the big event, but on any other day. And I saw that more than ever, just as I saw as I was reading this passage, within the women in our congregation even. We saw Miss Alex there encouraging people. We saw her bringing her son along. And this is always something that I've really enjoyed, was that it's so amazing to find a young man and his mom so close one to another and serving God. You just do not see that very much these days. And I love that Miss Alex is always encouraging him to get involved and to minister and to get his hands dirty and help the man and to work in the labors and encouraging him as he goes soul winning and preaches the gospel. It's a great trait. I love seeing mom have. Miss Noreen, the same thing. I saw you yesterday smile like I hadn't seen in a long time. There's something lifted from your spirit. And I really enjoyed seeing you out cheerful and that sense of humor and that good spirit to the work that was there. It was honestly a blessing to my heart. Women, take some of these things that you see these women do. They get up early. They're prepared. They're ready unto the Lord. They're ready to do these things. And I saw all these things. I saw Miss Amanda. She's not here yet, but she works so hard to keep and to bring her kids within the nurture and admonition of the Lord. But it spills out because now she's trying to save that whole neighborhood. We got a bus ministry all contained within her van there as she seeks to bring kids, and do that sort of thing. I've seen someone like Miss Michelle, she was here, and she isn't always here, but she encourages, and I know she prays for this church from afar and has that portion in this ministry. And then even now my wife, I don't know if she can hear in there, but she's consistently encouraging me. She's a laborer in and of herself, and even when she left because our fussy little toddler needed to get some rest, she wanted to make sure that she was involved in the ministry and involved in bringing in the sheaves, and she gave the gospel to a housekeeper, and got her saved yesterday. So she has her part even in the ministry yesterday. As I was reading through this, it just made me so amazed with recollecting and what happened and how the ladies contributed to these things. And I saw that portion of the scripture just jump out at me. The women that were with them. I understand that was a group, but we really had great help yesterday because of the women that were with us in that. Yeah. Now, as men, sometimes the women will say things that seem as but idle tales to us. And forgive us because, you remember what happened in the Garden of Eden? You said something and we bought it and, we were tricked and duped by that. No, we were equally guilty, of course. But we need to understand, and I hope that the ladies here do understand, that the preacher appreciates you and loves you and cares for you and is so thankful for all the encouragement that you give me and so just envious of the balance that ladies can bring to a group like this. I think all the men are a little bit rough and tumble, but we do enjoy to have the women balance this out, be that softness within the congregation. It honestly really helps your preacher, and it really helps the men here. And we'll try better to not just think everything you say is but idle tales. We'll do our best. But hey, we're in good company, right? The Apostle Peter. So women, ladies, everybody here, meet with God. Prepare your heart unto the work early in the morning, best you can. Make that be the first cry of your heart. Oh God, thank you for this morning. And just get in the word as I know you are. Pray unto him as I know you are. But be steadfast in these things. Be immovable. Even though you're going to get let down, you're going to get frustrated, you're going to get hurt because you expected to see something of your Savior and it was the opposite. And then you recall, oh, that's exactly what he told me. And be encouraged that when you get it, when you understand it, it's yours to tell. It's yours to bring to all of us. It's yours to contribute. And that is indeed, I believe, the contribution that ladies make within the congregation. They are that other side, that other perspective that even though we don't get it, we are, we would eventually hear that same thing. So meet with God, prepare your hearts, and don't fear. See, this is the problem with men, is that as it is in verse 12. Then arose Peter and ran unto the sepulchre, and stooping down, he beheld the linen cloths laid by themselves, and departed, wondering in himself that which was to come to pass. He had to go and verify himself. So the lady's going to tell us something, and we're going to go, yeah. Well, all the time, man, we don't always have to just disbelieve and run and figure it out for himself. I like to think that the Apostle Peter eventually came back and was like, I'm sorry, Mary. I'm sorry, Joanna. You were right. And then eventually smoothed it out with all the men. Just a quick couple of thoughts about things that I noticed in this first portion of the scripture. Immediately after the resurrection, the first people given the opportunity to have clarity about what had happened, about the events that had happened, were the ladies. And I just love their heart to go and tell it. Even as within this church, I love the heart of the ladies who just desire to go and tell it, to be involved any way they can. And it's just an encouragement to my heart, and I thank you all for being here and for contributing.